You're listening to Scratch and Sniff Online with Nick Randall.
Hello and a very warm welcome to the very first Scratch and Sniff Online, formerly of RTE's National Radio in Ireland. And yes, after 4 years, we've broken free from our moorings and are about to soar into cyberspace with an occasional series of programmes featuring an eclectic range of interviews and music. Our special guest today has taken on Sontarans in Doctor Who, tropical diseases in Tenko, and the Mitchell brothers in Albert Square. And if you're looking for further clues, take a listen to these following extracts.
The man they were carrying was dead. He had been stabbed through the heart.
Really, miss? And how can you be sure of that?
I am a warrior of the Sever team. I know the different sounds of death. Now put our prisoner to the torture! Don't you doubt me! Not when Rose just lies there helpless, a living symbol of the bloody lot of us!
Oh, hello, Jim.
Susan, I was wondering, how are you fixed for dinner tonight?
Tonight, no, I can't. I'm having dinner with a client.
Could you get out of it?
You mean the way you're always getting out of your work to come and have dinner with me?
She destroyed Beppe, you know. 18 months it took us to put him back together again. We took turns to look after Joe. We kept the restaurant running. It nearly ripped us apart. You want to be a DeMarco, my girl? You better start behaving like one.
Ladies and gentlemen, trance beings and multiforms, give it up for the English rose that is Louise Jameson. Well, Louise Jameson, thank you so much for coming on board Scratch and Sniff Online, our very first show since we parted amicably with RTE, and we wanted an A-lister on, so we got you.
Oh, I had no idea this was the first. I feel very honoured.
It is. It's the very first one that's going to go out, so hopefully a lot of people are going to enjoy this, obviously for the 50th anniversary of Doctor Who, but for me, it's not just about Doctor Who. I want to talk about all the stuff you've done. You have had so many wonderful parts over years, theatre, TV, you know, you've never been away.
Oh, which is, I've been very lucky.
Which is a real achievement, especially for an ex-Doctor Who girl. No disrespect to any of the others, but from the original series, I would say the most successful in terms of diverse high-profile roles afterwards.
I think I was lucky in as much as I was accepted at RADA at 17,
right,
and out and trained at 19. And pretty soon after that, I went to the Royal Shakespeare Company for nearly 3 years. And they took me all over the world and continued my training. So I came to Doctor Who with a full-on classical background and had got myself just a little bit of a name in the theatre before I ventured into a series. It was a very deliberate
decision. I'm surprised they backed you, actually. I mean, it was just something. I mean, well, we can get into that later because obviously, I guess you were looking for TV experience, but in a long-running show.
Well, my agent was very keen that I raised my profile on the TV.
Yeah,
I'd done odds and sods. I was the first person to get murdered in a soap.
Oh, lovely.
In Emmerdale with Fraser.
Oh, yes, Fraser Hines.
Yes.
Yes, cotton socks. When did you get that initial eureka spark that you wanted to tread the boards?
Aged four,
right.
I'd played Little Miss Muffet,
okay,
rather triumphantly.
To your school or...?
To my school, to all the mums. And when I leapt up, Judith Black was the spider, and when I leapt up and screamed, they'd given me, rather stupidly, a glass bowl of curds and whey, and it shattered.
Oh, dear.
And I screamed and I ran off and they came and I literally stopped the show because, of course, they had to clean the floor.
It was a showstopper.
Yes, all those little four-year-old barefoots.
Yeah.
But I remember the mothers really laughing and clapping, and I remember distinctly standing the other side of the door going, yay, this is what I want to do.
Fantastic.
I know, it's extraordinary.
Were your parents in the profession? Or?
My mother was Queen of the Amdrams. She was a wonderful actress, actually, a really good actress. And I think she made a very conscious decision to make her career motherhood.
She As indeed did Elizabeth Sladen during those years when she brought up a daughter. She pretty well wasn't working, I think.
Yeah.
So motherhood has to be at the top of the list. When was your first professional role then? I mean,
the very first thing that went out was one line with Marty Feldman. I went up and just did one line in his show. And the line was, "Dead cats turn me on." And my agent said, "Will you call me if you get a punchline? Because if you've got a punchline, you get more money." So I rang her up and told her the sketch and I told her my line. And she went, "Well, is it a punchline?" And I went, "I've absolutely no idea." And when it went out, they dubbed a laugh over it. So it obviously was a punchline.
Yes.
Yeah. I was painting his boots with nail varnish while I did it, wearing a big floppy hat. It was a very bizarre day. That's the first thing that went out. The first thing I did was Cider with Rosie. I had four lines in Cider with Rosie, and that went out on Christmas Day 1971.
Well, that's a nice treat for your family.
It was lovely.
Oh,
wasn't
how
it?
Wonderful.
Yeah.
That's really
and
nice.
It was a real treat for my dad because my mum said that we weren't getting a colour television set until I was on the telly. And of course, in May, I got May the 1st, I got my first job. Right. And Dad went, "Right, colour telly then."
That's fantastic. Did your parents, once they realised you were serious, encourage you or were they quite
they
resistant
kind of did
to
both.
It?
I got a bit of a mixed message. They said, "You've got to get another qualification. We don't care what it is." Yeah. So I looked around and I learnt to touch type. I'm a really good typist, really good. I don't know how many words I
do. I use one finger, as it were. And
I'm terribly grateful. Of course, we'd no idea how computers were going to develop back in 71, or that I would at any point become a writer.
Mm.
So how useful is that? I mean, it's just wonderful. I did try and learn shorthand as well, not terribly well. I just put the odd secret in my diary and sure. The day I lost my virginity, I wrote that in Pittman's shorthand.
Oh, it's exclusive here on Scratch and Sniff. I mean, even if I do a text, I'm always subbing it because I don't want, or something on Facebook, because I don't want people thinking I can't spell.
So, well, I can't spell, so, you know,
I'm hopeless.
Spell
I'm always
amazing.
Asking Andy, my lovely partner, how to spell the most ridiculously easy words, and bless him, he'll just rattle them all out.
Are you dyslexic?
I don't know. I don't. Perhaps I might be mildly.
There are certain. Is this boring? Can I just say no? Because I'm a bit, and my kids both are. So I know a lot about dyslexia.
Oh.
If anybody's listening who is dyslexic, I would urge you to read a book called The Gift of Dyslexia by Ron Davis, DAVIS.
Okay.
And they talk there about trigger words because basically dyslexics are picture thinkers. So if something doesn't have a picture attached to it, it becomes very difficult to spell. So words like through, for, under, in, of, they trigger the brain because you can't attach a picture to it. And then a little panic sets in and then everything goes haywire.
Scratch and Sniff.
So let's talk about drama school. Let's just move back a little bit and talk about when you made the decision. You went and got in successfully to RADA.
Yeah.
I mean, I think you're only one of two assistants from the original series.
And Mary was in my town.
Mary Town, So, I mean, they obviously picked quality there. What was it like?
I loved it. Hmm. Our term had a decade span in it. You know, I was 17 and the oldest person was 27 or 28 even. And they had more trouble with it because it was quite school-oriented. If you were late three times, the third time you were kicked out. That was it. That was the discipline. These kids don't have it nowadays.
Mm, mm.
They were so hot on punctuality and so hot on never missing a show.
And can I say that you arrived absolutely 5 o'clock, whereas me, who's usually late for my own funeral, was there half an hour early, panicking like anything. Has she gone to the wrong entrance?
I'm normally there a touch earlier. I mean, I did skim in.
It's fine. We'll let you off this once. Now, you studied the teachings of, can I pronounce it properly?
Stanislavski,
who was very much a sort of motivational actor and tapping into inhabiting that person. Mm-hmm. And apparently you've taken this with every role you've done since. Is that right?
I think actors do it almost instinctively.
Yeah.
You find a little bit of yourself and you expand that. You blow it up like a balloon to take over the whole character. But basically, you have to step on stage wanting one thing, the objective.
Mm.
And basically, there is something in the way, the obstacle. So you need to be really clear about what your objective is, what the obstacle is, and how your character decides to move their way around it. I think it's an amazing form of teaching kids. It's a fantastic tool. It teaches the profession. It treats the profession with such respect. However, I don't think it should be the only form of teaching.
Okay.
You also need to know about breath control and rhythm and try thongs and how to use the punctuation.
Becoming
and,
trees.
I have played a tree in a production of A Midsummer Night's Dream.
Fantastic.
At RADA.
Okay.
He made us. He made the entire cast of... I'm doing it. It's not very good for radio, is it? Made the entire cast a forest.
It's a fantastic tree, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah.
Yeah, convincing.
Yeah, it worked, definitely. Oh.
So... And then we all would fall, you know, like Oberon and Titania. So we had our backs to the audience in all this camouflage. And then we would turn around and be the fairies. So it was it was theatrically very interesting. So there is a space to be a tree. It's bloody boring to stand there for 20 minutes.
Well, yeah, I would have thought so. Scratch and Sniff. You have a theatre background, don't you?
Yeah.
So that's your first true love?
Yes.
But, and that's because of the immediacy of from the audience?
Of, yes. Yeah. It's the ancient art of storytelling, isn't it? You take something right from the beginning and the audience leave the theatre a little bit changed.
Mm.
Be they happier, sadder, more thoughtful, they want to discuss something. I think you have an effect on people, and I think there's something about group energy that is indescribable, really.
How difficult was it to adapt your skills for TV then? I mean, did you have any training at RADA for television acting?
Then, no, right. None at all. No, I think we had 2 hours with a cameraman once in 2.5 years. Doctor Who taught me my camera work and almost exclusively Pennant Roberts about hitting marks, finding lights.
Mm. Television director, of course.
Yeah. Bergerac 2 taught me a lot because John Nettles
single is... camera stuff, wasn't it, though?
Yeah.
Yeah.
John Nettles is the master of camera technique. And he would say things like, look, you know, if the camera was over his left shoulder, he'd make sure I looked at his left eye and not his right eye so the camera had more of my face. Just tiny little things
detail.
Like that. If you look at the sun with your eyes closed for 6 seconds, you can open them for about 6 seconds without having to squint. The sun is directly ahead. Just little tricks like that. He taught me, which doesn't touch on Stanislavski.
No, you know, no.
Stanislavski would completely reject that form of technique.
He was a Russian director and an actor as well, wasn't he? So he apparently inspired socialism in Russia. Am I right?
I had a mother out of law. I lived with somebody for 5 years during my 20s, and his mum was a woman called Virivlasova,
who I'm glad you said that.
who knew Stanislavski and lectured on him in 7 different languages around the world. She'd also worked with Chekhov's nephew.
Wow.
So I have, you know, just a little bit of
connection there.
Yeah.
Oh, that is very,
but she was extraordinary.
Very cool.
You know, we'd say to her, do you want a cup of tea, love, in the morning? She'd go, no, don't worry about me. I'm just depressed. That's all. I mean, it was full on.
Show me to the next whiskey bar.
Yeah.
Oh, show us the way to the next whiskey bar. Oh, don't ask why. Oh, don't ask why.
Scratch and Sniff. So there's been a lot of big productions you've worked on: Romeo and Juliet, The Taming of a Shrew, King Lear, a passion play. Tell us about some of the most rewarding roles that you've done on stage.
I think the breech ladies really stand out from Shakespeare. You know, the ones that get dressed up as boys. They're such fun to play because you can be slightly sacrilegious with it all. And I played Rosalind in As You Like It in Regent's Park.
And oh, wonderful.
Yeah, really loved doing that. We started that in Nottingham and then had to move outdoors with it. So a lot of the subtlety went, but I suddenly understood Shakespeare in a way that I hadn't before. This is the early 80s, because the whole thing had to be so pumped up. The best time to watch out of outdoor theatre is after it's rained. After it's rained. Because the leaves are heavy with water and they don't rustle. So you haven't got, if there's the slightest breeze, you haven't got that, because Regent's Park is that, there's really lots of trees. going on while you're trying to tell someone that you love them rather delicately. Yeah. And of course, I did it before they had any microphones or anything.
You're actually taking me to a completely different thing in TV when you're in the Amiga Factor and you had this wonderful hair, but it was like, it was a serious outdoor scene and it was like, it was here, it was there, and continuity must have been an absolute bugger.
I remember that day. That was up Edinburgh Castle.
Oh, that was
with
it.
Jimmy
yeah.
Hazeldine. I remember yeah. the day. We were so cold.
Absolutely.
And cursing the fact that we hadn't decided on a ponytail for that.
Oh, yeah, that
particular
would be good.
Piece of filming.
Or a hat or something like that. You worked with Ian McKellen as well.
Action. Wizard, you shall not pass. Cut.
I have.
So, that was really interesting. I had a very difficult time on that show. It was called Marquis of Keith, and I had to play a sort of rather dowdy wife in it, and he had this rather glamorous mistress played by Sarah Kestelman, and that was really my first big role at the RSC, and I don't think anybody quite trusted me. Once I got on stage and got going and they all left me alone, the part came to life, but actually during rehearsals I got shouted at quite a lot. Wasn't nice. Not by Ian. Oh, Ian never did. And he had a stalker that time as well. It was a rather fraught time at the RSC. Gosh. It was all a bit peculiar, the whole process. But as I say, once we were up and running, the whole thing went brilliantly.
So, OK, so obviously you've established yourself in the theatre after going to RADA, the Royal Shakespeare Company, done some wonderful work, but then your agent says, hey, it's time to try a different discipline, yeah. raise a profile.
Yeah.
And apparently you got down to the last three per
ten,
in the Avengers.
Last ten. Yes.
Oh, well, let's say three.
And, weirdly enough, so did John Nettles.
Eh?
And
oh, well, not as Purdy, sorry.
No, but for the
guy.
Yes.
Yeah.
And somebody gave me a bit of paper, and we were partnered up together with question marks beside us as a possible duo to go.
How prophetic is
that? I've only just found that out.
Right.
I don't think he knows, actually. I'll have to show him the
How
paper.
Would you have felt if you got that job then?
I mean, oh, well, you know, who wants Joanna Lumley's career? No, I'd have been thrilled, as thrilled as, you know, Doctor Who. It was, and I went up for Angels, got very close to that.
Yes,
that didn't happen.
Remember that.
Went up for The Survivors. That didn't happen.
Abby's part?
Don't know.
Oh, you wouldn't know the names now, but one of the main characters.
Right. So, which in actual fact, I got Doctor Who because of that interview, because that was another Pennant Roberts interview. And Pennant had a little black book where he had all his actors down and he put stars by how good they were. Apparently, I had a few stars by my name, so I was called in again when it came to Doctor Who.
So, it was only a matter of time, really. It was just like, which big role were you going to get? And
do you know, I think I felt that confident then, yeah. It's funny,
fantastic.
Isn't it?
Well, there's nothing wrong with being, you've got to be.
Yeah. We just thought, well, we'll go for a TV series, and we did.
Yeah.
And it happened.
How did you feel when you got that? I mean, were you much of a fan? Did you know about the show?
Oh, yes. It was an absolute family event. I mean, it started when I was 12, and we weren't allowed food in our living room. My mother was quite strict about that. We always had to sit around the table or eat in the kitchen. Mm. And we were allowed it on when Doctor Who was on. It was a big family. Dad came home from the snooker club and we had a trolley with the eggs and the baked beans and
how cool that you loved it and then you were in it. I just think that it's fantastic.
Absolutely loved it. But I tell you, I remember sitting on my... I had a sort of put-you-up. I had this little flat in West Hampstead and I sat on the put-you-up and I thought, right, now I've got to put the phone down. I was on my own in the... No mobile phone or anything, because, of course, you'd be straight on the mobile phone, wouldn't you, to your nearest and dearest? Nothing like that. Mm. I sat there and I thought, well, I can get those shelves put up now and I'm going to meet the Daleks.
Exterminate!
And neither of those things happened.
Oh, you didn't do the shelves even?
The shelves never got put up.
Because there was no Daleks, no.
And I never met the Daleks. Oh. I've met them on Big Finish work.
The Dalek ship? No, we cannot go there. There will be Daleks waiting to ambush us.
Can I show you this letter? I got this lovely letter. I don't know which camera.
Try it over on four.
Five. I got this lovely letter from a girl called Catherine. Please, could you start putting clothes on? Love from Catherine.
Savage.
found floating down the Amazon in a hat box. A hat box?
What was it like wearing all that chamois leather as Leela?
It was terribly uncomfortable.
Chafing?
It was really, really uncomfortable. They very sweetly put a little leather flap on the back for me because I was very conscious of my arse. Always have been. So I wanted to put a little, you know, little
I'm sure some of the
vanity.
Dads after the football results appreciated it as well.
But then, and it took hours to pee because I had to had to take the whole thing off. But,
intergalactic pee.
But then...
Did they have a loo in the TARDIS?
Of course, they've got everything in the TARDIS. They had a swimming pool. They must have had a lavatory in the changing room. But so then they did a little alteration and it became much easier.
Listen, Doctor, I do not like the way you keep talking about my ancestors.
I like your new dress.
Thank you.
But you were the original owner or co-owner of K9.
Mistress?
I was.
The owner. That hasn't been forgotten.
I know.
Respects of the late, the great Elizabeth Sladen, who, and I read in her autobiography that apparently when she left, and quite understandably, well, she wasn't a particular fan. Her sort of feelings were, I mean, it was no disrespect to you because she didn't know you at the time, but just that, well, I don't want to see the doctor with his new girlfriend, you know, because it would, you know, she'd find it difficult. But apparently she was with her husband, Brian Miller, in a theatre in Richmond. And you happened to be in the bar. And you apparently you went up to her and said, oh, hi, I'm going to be the new Doctor Who assistant.
Yes, I remember that.
And she you said, oh, can you give me any tips? So that was your first meeting with her all those years ago.
Yes, I've completely
I only know this from
that.
Reading the book, yeah.
Completely forgotten that. And, of course, when Mary got it, she was on the phone going... How much are they paying you? What's Tom Baker like to work with?
Absolutely. Oh, dear. So, I mean, we don't really have to go into big detail. It's been documented very well before, but I guess Tom Baker had been working with Elizabeth Sladen from the beginning of his thing, and Leela was a very different character.
Yeah, she invited him into the series, and then he was established by the time
Absolutely.
I came.
Absolutely. So, I mean, it presumably certainly didn't show on screen. I mean, it was absolute tight performances.
I think, if anything, you know, I think we've always had enormous respect for each other's abilities and talent and intelligence. I don't think that was ever in any doubt. The fact that we didn't really get on personally, you know, we're professionals. We're both very, very professional.
In a sense, it's not relevant. I mean, it sounds cold, but it's you're there to do a job.
I think it almost added to the frisson, you know.
Are you all right? You are very heavy.
How did you find me?
Well, I just felt something was wrong, so I followed the feeling.
Yes.
I did.
Yes, of course you did.
Hey.
What?
Have I saved your life?
Yes.
Because whatever tension we felt could be channeled. We weren't indifferent to each other. That would have been something horrible.
Yes, absolutely.
And now I'm so fond of him. It astounds me that, you know, up to about 5 years ago, I'd have said, you know, he's the one person I would never work with again.
Gosh.
And there are probably. Three people. But you know, that's in a whatever it is, 45-year career. That's not bad going, is it? Three. I would just hate for anyone to go away with the impression that I don't love working with him, and that he's been hugely apologetic, and you know all that stuff. So
but
I don't.
But you're working with him on Big Finish.
Big Finish. We've
being
got eight.
Doctor and Leela again.
What are you up to, you darlings? What is it that you hope to achieve?
Control beam activated.
What are you doing to me?
Your mind is entering the first phase of robotization control.
You will not control me.
Cerebral scanners register above normal levels of instinctive independent thought. Power must be increased.
Get me out of this thing!
Yeah. Eight stories lined up for this year.
Oh, how exciting.
Yes, yeah. I'm writing one of them.
Are you?
Yeah.
That is fantastic.
I know, with Nigel, with Nigel Fares.
I love, yes, of course, Nigel Fares we'll get onto in a while, but I love the way that Doctor Who sort of feeds off all this creative energy, and then the next generation might employ people who worked there before, and it's just one big happy family that just grows.
There's nothing else like it in the business, and I think a lot of credit has to go to David Richardson, who's producer, one of the producers at Big Finish, and has a lot of brainchild children that he just feeds.
Yes, absolutely. Did you ever think you would come back to once you finish your job?
No.
And marry me off and whatever. And they didn't believe you were going to leave, apparently.
No, they didn't.
So that's why I have this awkward scene when suddenly you're going to hook up with
a Time Lord guard.
Time Lord.
Come on, what's the matter?
I'm staying.
Staying? Here.
Yes, I mean, it was not a good piece of writing, but it was, you know, they really hoped I'd change my mind, so they wrote something that was quite woolly. It was woolly enough to change at the last minute. So that was the thinking behind that.
It's a shame, but...
I'm sorry, I interrupted you.
No, I know. No, I just was. It was just a sort of a compliment. But I mean, I get the impression you're university liked, and people who are university liked, who give out a lot of good vibes, tend to attract nice people. So it doesn't surprise me. But there's only three people, and that's now two who are whatever. Because anyway,
yes, that's reduced to two. Yes,
it's reduced
absolutely.
To two now. I'm pleased about that.
And one
that.
Of the others is dead.
Well, we never liked him.
So
anyway,
we're down to one now.
Scratch and Sniff.
Now we have to talk about one of my all-time favourite TV dramas ever. I mean, I'm a huge Doctor Who fan, and we want to talk more about it for 50th anniversary, and that's what fans want to hear and stuff. But I want to talk about Blanche Simmons and Tenko.
Just figured out a humdinger bit of undermining. Guards hut. If you want faithful lookout, I can slip in and nick the duty roster. That should put their knickers in a twist.
What's the point?
Point?
Point.
Well, don't you start.
For one short moment when I thought Rose had got away, there was hope for us all. But now...
That...
14 months, 1 week, and 3 days, and where has hope got us? Myrtle, gangrene. Mrs. Chang, septic, something gone wrong. And her, and her, and her, and Debbie, and our Sal, and you were good out when you saw one.
Don't me! Not when Rose just lies there helpless, a living symbol of the bloody lot of us.
Where there's life?
Life! When each time they die, so do bits of us, the dead burying the living. Let me tell you something. Out there somewhere, inside what's left of Sylvia's brain, there are things I've felt only she understood, cow that she was. And I can't even remember what they were.
What's so special about you, all of us, but even me? What the hell's it matter what we've lost? As long as it's not our anger.
Anger? I can't even feel that, not any longer. Even for Christina.
I love Blanche. You know, I think Blanche and Leela are very similar. If you know, they have no censorship between their brain and their mouth. They're feisty. They work on instinct. They're both uneducated. Mm. They both live in their respective jungles and are survivors, come what may. Mm. So I think there's a great similarity. And again, Pennant Roberts casting me.
But what a wonderful part to get or to be offered after Doctor Who, something so completely different.
Well, you know, I was originally offered Rose. Do you know this?
I didn't know that.
I was offered Rose.
Played by Stephanie Beecham.
And they said, come in and meet Ken Reddington, the executive producer. It's just lip service. He just wants to cast an eye over you. And he took one look at me and he went, you're much too much of a tart. He said, I think you should play Blanche. And I was put in this privileged position. It's not happened before or since or anything like it in a room like this with seven scripts which weren't allowed out of the building. Mm-hmm. And I had to read them all and a synopsis for a further two. And although Blanche had at that point three fewer episodes, she didn't get to go to Singapore or Kuala Lumpur like the others did. Yes. Didn't come in until we got to the camp. I just knew it just leapt off the page. I just thought, this woman, I know this woman. She's in many respects everything I would like to be. And because of that, I didn't start work until 6-7 weeks after all the others. So I slipped in a little job at Bromley called Whose Life Is It Anyway? At Bromley Theatre. Right. And I met the father of my first child.
Oh, wonderful.
So Harry would never have existed.
Yes.
If I'd accepted Rose. Isn't
it's
funny?
A lovely way jobs link with the personal side as well.
And when I was asked to go back into Doctor Who, if I'd accepted that, Tenko would never have happened.
Yes, of course, John Nathan Turner wanted you back.
Yeah, to oversee Tom leaving and Peter joining. But he wanted me back for a whole season. In fact, he wanted me for two.
It's quite an unusual thinking, actually, once somebody's left, to do something like that. I can understand why he would want you.
He wanted the fans not to feel, because Tom was so established as the Doctor, wasn't he? He'd done, what, six, 7 years?
Yeah, 7 years.
7 years. Yeah. He was so established as the Doctor, his thinking was that they wanted he wanted the fans to have somebody that they felt comfortable with, that they knew. It's quite a clever idea,
really.
It was
a completely new lineup of three people, which was quite unusual. Doctor? 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 Did you meet any of the survivors of the prison of war camps?
Yeah, we had a woman called Molly who was on set.
Molly
permanently.
Smith.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember the name coming up on the credits. Camp advisor, it said.
Yeah. She was there from 10 to 14. She was in a camp and her mother died while they were there. And she never sat down. She stood very straight with her handbag in front of her all the time, holding onto her possessions. And there was one day, she and I were chatting on the edge of the studio, so we were all in costume. And one of the guards walked past us to get into position, and she went like this and did
Jesus.
This terrible, and she just looked at me. She was very short. She looked at me, she said, "I'm so sorry." She said, "I thought I'd got through all that."
That's
and
awful.
I just thought, just that tells you so
and
much.
And it's just a setup for a TV show.
How much she suffered.
And Lavinia Warner was
Darling Vin, yeah.
She was also in the same position, or was she an internee?
No, Lavinia was a researcher for Whose Life Is It Anyway?
I'm with you. So she's the one who brought the story out.
Yeah, right. And she left doing her researching job when she'd researched, because it wasn't always celebrities. Mm. Sometimes it was just people who'd done pretty heroic or wonderful things. And she was so fascinated by this particular woman's story that she gave up her job as a researcher, wrote a book called Beyond the Wire, and then produced this amazing series, which it sounds so wanky, but it was such a profound job. And for me, during my 2-3 years with it, I had two children. I became vegetarian. My mother died. I split up with my
a lot of memories.
A life-changing thing, one on top of the other, on top of the other. And four of those women said to me at some point, do you need somewhere to live? Because you and your baby can come and live with me if you need that. And that's family. And to this day, there's a hardcore, about six of us, that meet up so regularly. And, you know, births, marriages, deaths, first nights.
Someone who played Dorothy, you're a good friend of hers.
Oh, Veronica Roberts.
Yes.
I think Ronnie's probably the best actress I've ever worked with. And she directed the show I'm touring with at the minute called My Gay Best Friend.
Right.
And it's the first time she's ever directed. And I would also say she's one of the best directors I've ever worked with. She's so talented. She's not terribly good at pushing herself forward. She's not a businesswoman, really. She's doing a Mike Lee film at the minute. So she's working at the minute, yeah. But you never know how much of it's going to reach the screen. She's got 6 months' work.
A lot of
might end up on the cutting room floor.
Ad-libbing
and,
Scratch and sniff. Now, of course, with Tenko, I mean, the writing as well. We had Jill Heim, who wrote some of the best episodes and then went on to do Howard's Way, but left because of what the BBC were doing to that programme. I mean, you had really good talent writing these scripts. Is it just so much easier when everything fits into place?
Yeah, it was Jill Heim and Valerie was the
and
other
Valerie,
writer on
it,
yes.
Yeah.
You always knew Anne's script because it was full of stage directions. And there's boils on her face and sores yes. running down her face. And Jill's writing was much sparser. She kind of slightly trusted the actress maybe a little bit more, she's trained as an actress. So maybe that's not to say, you know, one script was better or worse than the other. It was, you just knew who had written it without looking at the front page. I think because it was writing, because they really researched those two. I mean, they were so thorough. Because they were writing about women who had actually existed and that comes with a... That comes with such a sense of responsibility, as it does with the actresses. You know, we wanted to honour them in a way. That there was no such thing as a small detail, from, you know, the makeup department through to the where the full stop goes in the sentence. You know, everything was so. And Lavinia is really keeps an eye on everything. She's, some would say, a control freak, but actually. Look at the end result.
Yes,
you know,
she knows what she's controlling.
And she never upset anybody while she
Which
did it,
important.
But she was really clear about what she wanted and how she wanted it.
It was beautifully done. And it attracted some wonderful stars who, I mean, Stephanie Cole, Stephanie Beecham, of course, Anne Bell. Stephanie Cole, who's now in Coronation Street. Now, Stephanie Beecham, now this is a good one. She eventually got Sable Colby in Dynasty and the Colbys.
Yeah.
And I thought she was... You know, another dazzling talent. But like your work, in terms of the TV work, I think you've done some of the best stuff I've ever seen you in Tenko for TV. And with Stephanie, I felt the same as well. Obviously, she got this amazing golden ticket to do this thing in America. But, I mean, how would you feel if you were offered that part? Would you have gone for it, or would you be concerned that it might take you away from...
If I'd been offered it in my... 20s, I think I'd have probably been there like a shot. I was offered a Heart to Heart, and it was $10,000. You know, that was a lot of money in the 70s. But I turned it down because I'd already signed for Bristol Old Vic over here, and I was, you know, very honourable then.
Yes.
But that's a really interesting question. I think, yes, probably I would.
Okay. At the age... Yeah, the same time she got off with it.
But, you know, two small kids I had then.
Okay.
The priorities turn themselves upside down when you're a parent.
And it's also about what you do afterwards, being very well known for an American glossy soap.
Yeah.
I found with some of Stephanie's work afterwards, she obviously wanted to continue in America, but perhaps what was available wasn't... But there was so much more, I felt, to her as an actor. Without it being insulting to her.
You know, I think Steph almost suffers because she's so beautiful. I think there's a bit of her that thinks that's what she's got. And that's her,
that's
her unique selling point. I don't think she trusts her own talent. I agree with you. I think she's a terrific actress, but... sometimes what she looks like takes over from what she can produce if you leave that in the wings.
Is that a real struggle generally for women still?
Yes, especially now. You know, I'm 61. I went through, do I have a facelift? Do I?
You look gorgeous, my darling.
Thank you,
darling.
Do. Thank you. There speaks the gay fandom.
He's not one of them, is he?
But it's less of a dilemma. You know, I'm 61 now, soon to be 62. It was a big problem at 50, but I've kind of grieved my youth now, and I'm coming into this act three of my life.
Which you can rejoice in, and some wonderful parts, I would hope.
Unless
Dench gets them all.
She does get most of them, doesn't she? But, it's, you know, there was a time in my 20s where I had 12 potential jobs on the go.
Right.
That wouldn't happen now. It wouldn't happen now, not for me.
So it might require more work to get your get yourself out there as an older...
More patience. You know, I've just changed agents after 32 years. Cold Kitchen I've gone to, and they're terrific, and they're young and they're hungry, and I'm thinking that might just be what I need. But it's, you know, that phrase, it's like changing deck chairs on the Titanic. Yes. You know, changing agents. It's like, what's the point?
Was that quite an amicable split after so many years?
I was quite sad, actually. Okay. I was quite sad, but I had felt a bit sidelined, a bit forgotten, and agents are very interested in taking sweet young things and developing their career. Of course they are. So I think there was a little bit of ageism going on, but they'd served me terribly well over the years.
Which it is
was,
a good
so
full,
we,
full
we left
stop
going,
to that.
You know, thanks for everything.
Yeah,
and,
absolutely.
And good luck.
Scratch and Sniff.
You're listening to Scratch and Sniff Online with my special guest, Louise Jameson. And if any of you at home would like to contact us about this or any other show, then please seek out our Facebook page, SNS Online. Whilst the Doctor's favourite mode of communication, Twitter, which is Scratch and Tweet. Shows will be available to listen again by searching Mixcloud for Nick Randell, that's me, Soundcloud, SNS Online, and YouTube. Time to talk about a show now that one or two of you may have heard of. So let's talk about EastEnders, because obviously that was a, you know, a big part of your life, and you've got some very strong storylines. You had two of the sexiest sons in show business.
Didn't I? I've got two of the sexiest sons out of show business in real life
Yes, I saw a picture of one of them getting married. I thought,
They're both personal trainers.
Yeah. But that must have propelled you in a way that even Doctor Who and Tenko wouldn't, I
well,
would
have
thought.
When I got it, my agent rang me up and said, are you prepared for this? I went, what? He said, well, you know, the high profile. And I went, yeah, because I thought, well, I've had it since before, Doctor Who, of course.
Nothing
like it.
Terrifying.
I mean, it's really... I have a real love-hate relationship with being well-known. You know, it gets you tickets to theatres, it gets you seats in... restaurants, it gets you memberships to clubs, of course. What's not to like? You know, it gets you upgraded on a plane. It's fabulous, all that.
But you don't come across to me as somebody who has wanted to be an actor to be famous.
No, but there was a time when I did Bergerac, when I was doing Bergerac, and I was on the beach and walking, sunsetting, kids, lovely family moment. And somebody came pounding across the beach at me. I thought, oh, no, not here, not now. Leave me. Running towards me. And they ran straight past me.
No, come back.
There was a bit of me that, okay.
God, I would have a T-shirt. Pay me some attention. Absolutely.
So I thought, I'd take note of this, Lou, because actually you pretend you're fed up with it, but actually you quite like it. But there was, with EastEnders, you know, this. I used to do my supermarket shop while the omnibus was on to be able to get round. And I wouldn't go to a pub on a Friday night, because when you're recognised and somebody's pissed, it gets a bit invasive.
Yeah.
And when school's out, that was horrid. When you get 30 giggling, screaming, school, going, ah, Louise Rosa DeMarco! Screaming across a platform.
And again, you weren't given any counselling, or not counselling, but some sort of proper professional preparation for this.
No.
You see, that's what I find so odd. Like, with the X Factor, there just doesn't seem to be support.
When Jill Dando died, which was when I was doing EastEnders, huge shockwaves through the whole system. And they were all going, you've got to get CCTV on your door. You've got to go. I thought, you know, if you see where I live in the quietest, tiniest little village. It's the end of it. I haven't even got a road outside my door. I've just got this little path. And it's like, I'm not going to put cameras up here. What will the neighbours think? It's not, I don't want that kind of, and we had to get written permission even if we wanted to open our local fate. We had to. So that bit of it was just all a bit weird. And people going, where's Beppe, wherever I went? Where's Beppe? Yeah, I don't know. I'm not really his mother.
But I think a lot of people got very paranoid after the Jill Dando incident.
Did.
And It's like
we had
anything.
Our phones tapped, you know. Mm. We had a little dressing room each, and those phones were definitely tapped.
Oh.
But we all had mobiles by then, so
who'd be doing that then? Just rabid fans. Oh, the press, of course, yeah. To get whatever they could.
And our press department said, if you've got any secrets, let us know what they are, and we'll make sure nobody else finds out about them. Oh. You think, I'm telling the press department.
Yes, absolutely.
All the skeletons in my cupboard, think so. Well, the way to keep a secret is to not tell anybody.
Yes, well, obviously. We've all got those ones, darling. So you did that for, 2 years?
Two and a bit years.
And I know you would have liked to have continued for longer, but I guess New Brunswick.
I was told in the November that we were going to take over the Vic. Mm. Our family was going to take over the Vic. What did I feel about that? Mm. La, la, la. Would I be prepared to stay for 5 years? I think, both kids, single parent, both kids coming up to uni. Yes, absolutely. And then 3 months later, different producer. Yeah. And I'm out 12 weeks after that.
It's the old crossroads thing with old Noel Gordon and the sunglasses.
Are you expecting to be fired?
A faithful dog expect to be kicked. That shows my life.
I didn't mind going. It was a little bit of a relief. I mean, the bank balance minded. But I really hated that they told the press before they told me.
Ah, they obviously didn't handle it
well. Why would they do that? They said, we're worried you're going to go to them first. I think, come on. I've been in this business long enough,
But you did have happy memories. I mean, but obviously it was very hard work.
Oh, I love working with my family. Mm. Those kids, those four kids and the grandchild. Mm. You know, we were, and I think they were a bit pissed off with me because it's like in the lunch hour I would haul them, because we got no rehearsal at all. Mm. I would haul them into my dressing room and go, right, we're going to just bash lines now. And when we walked on the floor, the crew would go, oh, it's the DeMarcos. They knew they were going to have an easy time of it because we'd learnt it.
Yeah.
But they would do things like if they had love life problems in real life, they would come and tell me in my dressing room.
I would ask you, Louise. I would.
Would you?
If I had any issue, I don't, but you know.
And they would take off their coat and hand it to me. If the dresser wasn't around, they'd kind of throw it in my direction, like I really was their mum. And when Gary got her 8 GCSEs, you know, all that work, and she got 8 A-star GCSEs, we were like, you know, the family. We were just so proud.
You probably were together more than the family, I guess, in terms of the hours you
had. I did see more of them than I saw of my own kids. Yeah, it's true.
To think I stood by you over that brother of yours. This family gave you a job when no one else would touch her, and this is how you repay us? Excuse me? There's a girl who understands loyalty, I thought. I respect that. Just goes to show how wrong you can be. Out!
Mama!
Did you hear me? I don't know what she's told you, Jackie, but that woman put this family through hell. She destroyed Beppe, you know. 18 months it took us to put him back together again. We took turns to look after Joe. We kept the restaurant running. It nearly ripped us apart. Do you love Gianni?
We're very fond of him.
Yeah. See a future together, do you?
I don't know. I think so.
In that case, you want to be a DeMarco, my girl. You better start behaving like one.
Scratch and sniff.
Let's have a brief break, because we always have a Desert Island Risks slot, as I call it. Perhaps a piece of music that might have inspired you, either professionally, personally, that touched you in some way. Could you, the world's your lobster, as it were.
Okay, well, I've got two, actually.
Okay.
Without hesitation, I would say to you, love and affection, Joan Armour Trading. I've never met her, but I feel like she's a friend. She's seen me through the best and the worst. Mm-hmm. That Joan Armour Trading LP, long player for those of you that don't know, saw me through so much. Mm. And that was that whole Tenko time and that whole... to this day, comes out through my speakers. I went to see her. She was the last person I went to see in concert. But with a lover, I could hold my head back and really laugh, really laugh.
Thank you. You took me dancing across the floor, cheek to cheek. But with a lover, I can really dance, really dance, really dance, I can really move, really move, really. Now if I can feel the sun in my eyes and the rain on my face, why can't I
piece of music I absolutely adore is Bach Cello Suite Number 1. I think it's, I wonder, can I say this? It's a bit rude.
Say what you
like. I think it's the nearest thing to a female orgasm that you could ever hear anywhere. If you just sit and listen to it carefully, it's like, oh, nearly there, nearly there, nearly there. And then it just releases at the end.
You said it so beautifully. It wasn't dirty at all.
I just think it's a fantastic piece of music. And the cello is the nearest thing to the voice. Mm-hmm. Acoustically,
okay.
So it's a noise that you feel as well as hear.
Thank you. You're listening to Scratch and Sniff Online with my special guest, Louise Jameson.
Let's talk about a little bit more of your theatre work. You mentioned earlier that you were considering having a facelift. And you actually wrote a play about it.
Well, Helen Goldwyn wrote the play. And I had a very strong hand in it.
Okay.
You know. And yes, I went for my consultation, which cost me £100. And I booked it. And then I got a job and I was going to rebook it and I never did. We wrote the play instead.
Quite a scary process to even consider something like that. And what, was it more professional or was it a bit of...
Do you know what? I think it was the menopause.
Okay.
I think it just... I just got rather depressed at one point and my love life went all a bit cockeyed and just things weren't jogging on the way they had done up to that point.
You needed the tonic.
I did need a tonic and I thought a facelift would do it, which is just nonsense.
I think the people who do that, particularly in the industry, you know, perhaps are still angling for certain types of roles. But I think if you are lucky enough to get rewarding roles as an older actor, there is so much richness in.
I think you buy about 5 years, don't you?
Right.
Apparently the first one lifts it. For 5 years, then you can have another one which will give you another two, another one which will give you 6 months, and then you run out of skin.
Then
you begin to look a bit weird. Yeah. I mean, I do have contemporaries who've had facelifts and look fantastic.
Mm. That's something we mentioned earlier, actually.
the last 10 years, they've looked amazing.
Okay.
And it's just beginning now to look a bit like, doesn't quite work now.
Yeah.
I've had my chin completely taken away, and look at the difference. Look how thin I am. Thin and dainty.
Nice. Au natural is good. Moisturiser is all. Nothing wrong with that.
Moisturise me.
Let's talk about Brighton Fringe and your work with Nigel Thayers. Now, where did you first meet him?
Nigel wrote a script for me for Big Finish, a companion chronicle, Leela. And Helen Goldwyn was our mutual friend.
Right.
And so we just all kind of stayed in touch.
Mm-hmm.
And he became my gay best friend. And we've gone off and written a play called My Gay Best Friend.
Discovering my clitoris. I used to call it my toilet. Honestly. My mum used to say, have you washed your toilet? I didn't like it getting clogged up. My mum used to say, what are you doing? I said, I'm getting air to my toilet. She said, well, don't, it's not ladylike.
And also the my aliens, my mother's gay. You have to say it. I heard it this morning. It was fantastic. I just can't remember the title.
I chose this title. My mother was an alien. Is that why I'm gay? Mm. Because I have this gay fandom and I have this science fiction fandom. Yeah. And I thought that title would
just draw them all in. Draw them all. I bought it.
So this is an audio that you can buy from my website, louisejameson.com.
All right. I've packed. So, here we are again.
Yes, here we are again.
Why do you hate me so much?
Oh, don't be ridiculous. Stop feeling so sorry for yourself.
Charming.
You're pissed.
Of course I'm pissed. It's my birthday.
No, it isn't.
It's somebody's birthday.
It's Danny's birthday.
What?
Daniel, your latest lapdog, my boyfriend.
Oh, my God, is it? He didn't say.
That's why I came home early. I wanted to surprise him.
How sweet of you.
Yes, it was.
What a devoted boyfriend you are.
Aren't I?
Congratulations.
Thank you.
You play a delicious diva on it.
I play an aging science fiction star. Why he thought of me, I can't think.
It's a script. It's a very good script.
It's a very good script, I agree. Nigel, it's not me. I didn't write that one.
And you've worked together in the Brighton Fringe quite a lot, Honeymoon from Hell, the Acid Bath Murderers. I don't know, there's probably more, isn't there?
Is this more of a
rep type of...
No, we just go from one project to the next. The next thing I'm going to direct is Cruising, which is a musical which is going to the Brighton Festival, which
Gay
Nigel's related. Written. Yes.
Oh, it is.
What, with a title like
Cruising?
Well,
you know, you never know. It could be about around the world in 80 days.
So. I think it's a bit of both.
Okay, right.
And we've also got another play on the go, which we're mulling at the minute.
So there's a hive of creative talent going on.
And he runs writers' workshops, which you're going to come on.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. No, I'm very interested in that. As a failed writer so far.
Oh, don't ever. No, no, no writer's failed. You just haven't been recognised yet.
Oh, well, I want to take off my mum because she actually managed to do it.
Great.
So Big Finish, you're back with Tom Baker doing new stuff. You've also set up your own production company, is that right?
Yes.
TLC Productions?
That's it.
How sweet is that?
That's the one.
So you're
I'm very proactive.
Encouraging other new talents.
Yes, and I have a finger in a lot of those pies. You know, I'm in a lot of those shows because I just had to get creative as the work wasn't so prolific. Mm. What do I know about? Yes. What else can I do? I can teach, I can produce, I can write, and why not slip my own performances within all that?
Absolutely. Yeah. And this feeds into your drama course that you run.
I'm just taking a sabbatical from that.
Okay.
Because the writing side kicked in to quite an extent and I just haven't got time to do it all. So I do one-on-one with teenagers wanting to get into college. I have quite a good success rate with them. But I'm not running the full classes anymore.
But I was watching a news thing about some students that were just so, so enthusiastic about your approach and couldn't say enough lovely things about you. And it's sweet, isn't it?
She has her own experiences and it makes it better to hear it from someone who's done so much stuff.
She knows about things like audition speeches and especially like Shakespeare.
She knows her stuff.
Yeah.
They are adorable. I kind of fall in love with them a bit when I'm working with them. And I'm very non-PC as well, because you're supposed to say things like, do you mind if I put my hand on your shoulder? Do you mind? And
you can't say anything these days. You
just break all spontaneity. And it's got to be a very safe place for them to play, basically.
Yes, absolutely.
And the only thing I come down...
And to breathe creatively. Yeah.
The only thing I come down very heavy on is if they disrespect each other's work. Okay. It's very important that they hold that in the place so that everybody feels safe in the room.
Well, as an update to what Louise has been working on, let's take a listen to some examples of recent TV film projects, including The Mother-in-Law from Hell in Doc Martin.
When you were little, you'd always run after me and say you were sorry.
I'm not here to apologise.
You threw me out of your house.
You gave my baby alcohol.
Is that such a hanging offence? It never used to be.
You're never sorry for anything, are you?
Not this again, Lulu.
Well, you show up and you just expect to pick up where you left off.
What do you want me to say?
It's not about you or what you say, is it? It's more... Are you right? What's the point?
Of course I'm right. Now have a glass of wine, we'll talk about something else. Okay, Lulu?
Tales of Television Centre.
You never knew what bands were going to be around and you had to take your pass up on a Wednesday night because otherwise you weren't allowed in. The guy wouldn't let me in one night because I hadn't got my pass and he said, you might have walked off the street. And I was going, what, dressed like this? You know, open my dressing gown and I've got this leather leotard on. Then they believed I was either that or I seduced him enough to be able to go into the bar.
It's BBC One, it's tea time, which means it can only be time for pointless celebrities. Now then, Louise.
Hello.
You're my vintage of Doctor Who, Tom Baker.
Yeah, Leela of the Sever Team, warrior.
Yeah, leather-clad warrior.
When I left as a leaving present, they gave me a chamois leather.
Let's talk about this short film that you've done with Mark Gatiss called Cleaning Up, which is a thriller, which I think has won an award for
best... It's won two or three, I think,
right.
at the short film festivals.
12 minutes.
Yeah.
And you star in it with Mark and one other person.
Yeah.
And what was all that about?
Well, I can't tell you what it's about because it's got such a twist at the end. It's probably the funniest costume I've ever had in my entire life at the end. But again, I can't tell you.
Okay, so this is really quite new then.
Yeah, and I, he... Mark's fantastic. Mm. He's very sinister assassin. And I run a B&B and he stays with me. And that's how the story starts. But how will it end?
You're making me blush.
You're in a new children's BBC series, aren't you? Are you? Yes, you are.
Am I?
Yes.
Not me.
Yes, it is you. It's got lots of pictures of
kids.
Oh,
I know what you're seeing.
It's only you're in
yes,
the one episode.
Yes, I have. Yes, it's
Get
called...
a grip, Louise.
Sorry. God, I recorded it 6 months ago. It's been out already. That's the last thing I did for telly. It's called The Dumping Ground.
That's it.
And it used to be called something else, Tracy...
Oh, Tracy Beaker,
yes.
So it's following on from that.
It's the follow-on from that.
Right.
Yes, and I play this woman who runs a scam. She pretends she sees ghosts and talks to people on the other side and gets the odd fiver out of the kids for doing it. It's really horrible. So she comes over as this incredibly generous, lovely woman, but actually she's shitty.
I am sensing a young man. In his teens. In his 20s.
My brother?
Oh, yes, could be.
I guess for full stop on this, because we are at Doctor Who's 50th anniversary.
Yay.
I'm not a journalist. Are you ticklish at all? Can I get any information from you that way?
About what's going to happen?
Yeah,
no,
come on.
All I
come
know,
on, come
I on. Absolutely promise you this is all I know. I've been asked to keep those 3 days free.
Which days?
Over November 23rd. The date.
Oh, the actual date?
Yeah, that weekend.
Well, after they've done the thing. Okay, how
So I'm not... I haven't been asked to do any filming. I haven't been asked... But there's something happening over that weekend. But, you know, nobody's rung the agent.
Possibly a convention or something.
Nobody's talked fees.
This is such a mystery. Unless you... Well, I mean, you all are stellar actors. So, I mean, you know, this could be one big... No, I believe you.
I have heard a couple of other rumours about stuff, but...
They probably wouldn't be starting it yet. It could be literally
but
like
they
a...
they should be booking us now.
Well, absolutely, I would have thought so. I mean, I would really like to know how Leela's getting on and all the rest of it. I mean, how would you like to see... I know compared to, say, Blanche from Tenko, it was probably more challenging part to inhabit, I would have thought. Or to make convincing to the
who Leela was more challenging.
Yeah,
I think you're right, because basically, especially back in the day, she was there to say, "What is it, Doctor?"
Yeah,
so the
absolutely.
Doctor could then explain to the audience, and you have to make that role as convincing. I think Leela now, how is she now? Is
how,
that
how would you like to portray her
I think
if
she
you could
should
write
have a,
it? If you
I
could
think
write
she should be some kind of wise old guru with a football team of children behind. I don't think she'd be with Andred anymore.
Oh, no.
I think the children would all have different fathers. My two have different fathers, so I'm touching my own life here. I think she'd be some kind of... Not Buddhist exactly, but she would still have that...
The wise woman of the village
exactly.
About skincare problems or...
Exactly. Or no,
no I'm
more...
Being...
Yes, more... More profound than that. I think she would work on a kind of Nelson Mandela level.
Well, perhaps if it doesn't happen with Steve Moffat, you know, Big Finish, if they're listening to this, let's have an old
but
version.
But you know, they've got a wonderful. We've just recorded it. Wonderful CD coming out where they get all the doctors together.
I've heard of this, yes.
Yeah, and it's beautifully written by Nick Briggs.
Oh, Nick Briggs. Yeah. Right. The voice of the Daleks, of course.
Exterminate!
Yes. And now his scripts are normally, I mean, they're great, but they're normally chasing down corridors and things. And I always have a dizzy spell when I do one of Nick's because I'm by a microphone going like that,
absolutely.
You know, because she's out of breath. But this one is really clever about time folding in on itself. I can't tell you too much.
I'm
but
very excited about that. I am.
I was really impressed when I read it.
Fanboy's wet dream.
And Lala says things like, "Good God, you understand it?" Yes, of course.
Well, she's married to Richard Dawkins, isn't she? She should understand it all.
I've got a lovely Doctor Who story about
go on
that.
Then.
Okay, Tom Baker was the voice for British Telecom for a while. Yes. If you sent a text to a landline, Richard Dawkins took great delight in sending Lala messages in Tom Baker's voice to me. And I will be late home for supper today, darling. She would just freak her out completely.
That's so funny.
Knock, knock. Who's there? Doctor. Doctor who?
Yes.
Very good. Nice.
I never heard that before.
That's wonderful.
Is it an old one?
Well, the ingenuity, I think, is admirable.
Scratch and sniff.
Finally, we have a little scratch and sniff goodie bag for you. There's a couple of extra things in here, but at the moment, we'd just like you to go through them all. And each of these presents are a clue to one major pivotal role you played. Now, the only one you're not allowed to open till last is the wrapped up one.
Okay. So. Do you know my lovely Matt Evenden, for my 60th birthday, he organised a cake. Oh. And dotted around the cake were Russian dolls. You know, the one that goes inside the one. Mm-hmm. And each one of them was a different character that I played.
That
so
brilliant.
There's a very fat Blanche. There's a it's really sweet.
Take one out. Some of them a bit cheeky. Now, what have you got there?
I've got some blackberries.
Right. I think the focus fair is on berries.
Blackberries.
More than one berry. Two berries. Berry.
Oh, Tenko. Okay, I died of beriberi. I didn't actually. I died of pregnancy. They need to write me out.
That's why you left.
Jelly babies. Well, it's got to be Leela,
hasn't it?
Yes,
absolutely.
Hurrah.
Next one.
Pasta. Oh, Rosa DiMarco.
There's only one little packet there. It's kind of lonely, if you get what I mean. But I'm sure you can do something with that with all the skills. Now, the final one is your lucky charm for Doctor Who's 50th anniversary. Not only for the possibility of getting you on for the special, but for the rest of your life. So.
For the rest of my life?
Yes. It's a little Matt Smith, ladies and gentlemen, because you haven't appeared with him yet as Leela and the Doctor. But you will be, because we've decided, basically. So
I do appear
just rub him every night.
Ever so briefly in a... The screen flashes up all his different companions.
Oh.
Or was that when David Tennant was on?
I can't remember now, possibly. But there we go. So, Louise,
look at these arm gestures. Can I tell you about when I met David Tennant before
you can.
I go? Okay.
So no, go now.
So I'm up in Scotland, way before he got Doctor Who. And my niece has trained as a stage manager. She's now an artist living in France. But at that point, she was a stage manager, and David Tennant was doing theatre and education. Mm. And I went up to see the show to support my niece, Abby. And when he discovered that Abby's auntie had once been Leela in Doctor Who, he went, "Oh, can I meet her?"
Yes.
And he was brought over in the pub, and he was such a fanboy. You know, what was your favourite story, and what was Tom Baker like to work with? And, oh, I can't believe I've met Leela and all this. Okay, so fast forward to Mark Gatiss' Civil Partnership. We're at the wedding. And he gets brought over again to be introduced. And he goes, "Oh, it was absolutely lovely to meet you." And I went, "We've met before." And he went, "Well, I remembered, but I didn't think you would." And I said, "I can't." He was playing Hamlet. I said, I can't get tickets for Love Nor Money. And he went, "Leave it with me." First night, tickets, Hamlet, pink champagne in the dressing room. Oh. What a darling.
Fanboy made good.
Well, I'm a fangirl.
That's brilliant.
To be or not to be, that is the question.
Louise Jameson, thank you so much for joining the show tonight.
Thank you for asking me.
Our first ever Scratch and Sniff Online with my special guest, Louise Jameson.
Bye. Lovely to meet you.
Well, our thanks again to Louise and obviously to all of you at home for listening. For more on her work, go to louisejameson.com, TLC Productions and Big Finish Productions. Remembering Tenko, a celebration of the classic TV drama series, is also available in all good bookshops and online outlets. Future SNSs will feature public service broadcasting, Dear Zari author and Afghan Women's Hour presenter Zarguna Kaga, as well as music sets from Jaded Kid and DJ Pash. Look out for us in cyberspace. And as usual, never forget to keep dancing.